Hi, I'm Lori McNee with Art Beat, and I'm here today in my own home studio in Sun Valley, Idaho, with my really good friends and colleagues, Kyle Richardson and Eric Rhodes. And
I want to know why you mentioned Kyle first and you didn't mention me first. I know he's more important, but I just want to know what's going on here.
Well, he's the instigator of this whole thing.
That's a good point. That is a good point.
We wouldn't be here right now without him.
I am the troublemaker. That is usually right. That's usually what follows me.
So why are we all here together in
Sun
Valley?
So we're here today because we filmed a fun episode this morning, which is part of a larger clip that we're making, a TV series show that we're making about the arts. About our involvement with my company in the art world, with Eric's company, and plein air movement is part of what we're discussing as well. So the plein air aspect of it was something I thought would be fun to do with you up here in Sun Valley.
That's great.
Yeah, you've only been bugging me for like 10 years to come up here.
Exactly.
And you made us go
here
out into the snow.
That's yep. Right. Yep. You guys brought boots and all that stuff. Well, I'm from the East Coast. I probably could have just done with sandals.
But let's back up for a minute because I didn't introduce the fact of what you're doing anyway. You're CEO, or no, president of Royal Towns North America.
Sweep the floor sometimes too.
Okay, that's right. And then you are CEO of Streamline Publishing, publishers of Plein Air Magazine, Fine Art Connoisseur, and then you do the big, beautiful Plein Air Convention along with other things. So that's kind of what happened, is we've all come together to help promote plein air painting.
Sure.
And so tell a little bit more of what we just, I'm dressed like this because we were just outside in the snow. Plein air painting, which is, you want to explain plein air painting?
Plein air is a term, it's a French term essentially that means open air. And it was kind of coined at the time of the Impressionist. It was actually used as a derogatory term when they were describing Monet and friends. They referred to them as these plein air painters, these outdoor painters, which was highly unusual at the time. So that all kind of started back then and probably even before then. But today there's a huge movement of people going around the country, really around the world, and going outdoors to paint. So plein air painting means outdoor painting. And the benefits of it are that you see color and light more accurately than painting from a photo in your studio, for instance. Right?
Well, that's what I do. I am also a plein air painter as well as a studio painter. And I teach plein air painting workshops around the world, and some of you might want to go with me sometime.
You just did Giverny, right?
Yes, I was in Monet's Gardens in Giverny, and where that all started, the Impressionists, and then I also have been teaching in Lucca, Italy as well, which is a different vibe, just as fun. Just I love it so much. So.
Do you guys know why the Impressionists were the first ones to go out and be named plein air painters?
Well, no.
So there was actually, it's very interesting, it all ties back into first the Industrial Revolution. So
I know this.
Things happen. Before this, they had, you know, some painters could go outside with a pig's bladder.
Pig bladder, right.
And go out and paint, but not very many people did that. It wasn't very popular. It was not commonplace. But once they started to be able to make two different things, one was putting tubes, paint into tubes.
Right.
But
like
also
this.
The massive explosion of pigment technology that took place during that time as well, led to being able to have more colors available to replicate what was seen in nature more accurately.
So we have a lot of evidence that there was a plein air painting a long time before the Impressionists, maybe even so far back as Rembrandt's days, but they would have to grind color on location. So they'd take the pigment and they'd grind it, and then they'd have to mix oil into it. So it was a big ordeal.
Labor intensive and dangerous too. Because
there's a Hudson River School painter by the name of Asher B. Durand who described doing this. He would take a horse and buggy up to the top of a mountain, walk up through the trees.
An off-road one.
Yeah. And then he was talking about having to grind his paints on location. So the tube revolutionized everything. It's something we kind of take for granted.
That's true.
And now there are actually some people who don't even use tube paint, they use iPads.
That's true.
Don't tell me that.
That is true. But we're not here to talk about that today.
No, that's fine.
So, okay.
Not very many. There's only two people in the whole world doing it.
Yeah, Cassie.
So tell us a little bit about the process of making paint real quickly, because that's pretty interesting.
It is. You know,
Royal Towns is based out of?
Well, sure. I'll start with that.
Okay.
So Royal Towns, I'm the president of Royal Towns North America. I live in Northampton, Massachusetts. And It is a 120-year-old company, not mine, not North America, but
you're looking young.
Doing all right. It's all the painting. But the company is based in the Netherlands, the parent company, where they make the paints. It's been around since 1899. It's a Royal Dutch company, which is for Americans, the cliff notes of that would mean it's kind of like being knighted as a company.
I think that's so interesting.
Yeah. It's really cool. It's a really fantastic, wonderful company. They're very proud. They make very, very incredible quality products, a lot of which artists use, all not just plein air artists. But
so did it start out, it was called Talons Company, and
it
then
was called Talons.
And then it became Royal Talons.
Right.
Oh, that's
so
cool.
It started out as Talons Company making inks and lacquers in Apeldoorn in the Netherlands, 1899. And in 1949, in their 50th birthday, the Queen of the Netherlands actually designated it as a Royal Dutch Company, like Royal Dutch Shell, Royal Dutch KLM. So that was a big honor, and it's something that they still are very proud of. So I run their North American operations in the business in North America, and that's how I've gotten to know you guys.
Yes.
And it's really fun to be engaged with the art community and not just at a company that you're making a cog widget and some of it here.
And I met you due to Eric at the plein air convention, world famous plein air convention, where I say big things happen there, you know. And and Kyle and I met, and I became an ambassador artist to Royal Talons. Mm-hmm. And then Eric and I have schemed things over the years, schemed up things, and we've made some DVDs together. And I've been featured in his beautiful magazines. And talk a little bit about what you're doing.
Well, my story is this. Essentially, I was a painter. I became a painter when I was 40. My wife bought me an art lesson, but it was all abstract and modern. Not that I have anything wrong with that. It wasn't what I wanted to do. I wanted to learn how to paint a still life or a model.
Yeah.
And so I started learning to paint, studied under this master portrait and figure artist. Mm-hmm. And then we moved to California. I started a .com out there, something that, you know, during that .com era. And while I was painting, my wife noticed that she couldn't stand the smell of the paint, and she was pregnant with triplets. And so I had to get the paint out of the house. And so she forced me to go to the garage. And then she said, "It still stinks, get out of the garage." And so I thought, well, I'll paint outside. I never knew that people painted outside. I didn't know about the plein air thing. I didn't know what plein air
it was very small. Yes.
And then so I went out to the golf course. I took a full-size studio easel. I took a card table, a chair, and a box of stuff.
Did you bring your own pigment and oil to grind out there?
I didn't know about that at the time.
Okay.
So my canvas, I used a regular canvas, kept blowing off, and you know, it was really a difficult thing to do, but I was determined I wanted to paint. So I later learned that there are some people who were around that did this thing called plein air painting. Mm-hmm. And so I started taking some lessons, and they taught me how to get the right kind of gear to go outdoors and make it easy. And I became obsessed with it. And then I went to an event, and there were maybe 100 people there that were plein air painting. And I thought, well, this might be a movement. And so I started a magazine called Plein Air Magazine. And well, it may not have been a movement. It wasn't quite ready yet, but we've really been promoting it now for 15 years.
Right.
And we started a convention, plein air convention.
Yes.
And because of that now, there literally are tens of thousands, possibly hundreds of thousands of people who are looking at this and saying, you know, I want to do this too.
Around the world.
Yeah, yes. Not to be necessarily a professional, although some are, but just to enjoy going outdoors.
It's a wonderful pastime.
And mm-hmm. and the benefits, as a painter, the first benefit is that you see light and color differently.
Right.
Because it's different than a photograph, as mm-hmm. I mentioned. But the other benefits is, you know, you're getting outdoors. Like, I've never been very athletic, mm-hmm. but I like to be outdoors, and it gave me a reason to, you know, you set up. And when I was a photographer, I'd go to the place, I'd take the picture, and I'd leave. And now I go to the place, I set up, and I stay there for 2 or 3 hours, mm-hmm. and I paint. And I, you know, sometimes a deer leaps in front of your canvas. You remember a lot of things about it.
Right.
And so, and it's very social, right? Mm-hmm. There are a lot of people who like to go out and paint together.
Well, like we just did.
Communal.
We had a good time out there.
They like to travel together. And it challenges your brain, you know? So, and it's something that, you know, you can do for the rest of your life. You can do
keep improving. We've talked about that. As we get older, many things we start not doing as well. And with painting, you can keep improving with age.
Actually, and they're finding now that painting actually helps prevent Alzheimer's.
Yeah, I've heard that too.
You know, so it cognitively, it's challenging your brain all the time, as long as you're constantly learning and growing and trying new things.
At the core of it, it's problem solving. That's what you're doing.
You're trying to
Work against the elements of light changing,
quickly.
Shapes changing in a quick way, and establishing shapes and values and lines and color all at the same time. So it's like a giant equation. So your brain is trying to figure that out. And at the same time, while it's doing that, it's not doing all the other stuff that gives you stress and gives you, you know, all the other issues. So it's really great.
And on the wall behind the guys here are some examples of my plein air paintings from around the world. And I've kept them as little postcards to myself, and they inspire me and remind me, trigger the great memory of where I was standing for an hour or so, and just brings it all back.
You know, we're living in a digital world, and our photos are on our hard drives that, you know, it's not going to be like our kids going through our old photo albums and looking at grandma and grandpa or great grandma and grandpa. They're probably not even going to find this stuff. And
that is a good point.
When you have a painting that you've done, and you've done it with friends, and you have memories of the time, and that painting's hanging on your wall, and I don't sell those paintings. I keep those my studies, my small ones, because I want to just remember.
Yeah.
And I'll go out to my studio and look at them, and I'll remember who I was with and what I was doing, and it's so wonderful. So I'm curious. I'm going to ask you a question, because this is a great debate, both of you. The question would be...
He's usually the interviewer, is what's happening here.
Taking his natural position.
He's so uncomfortable with it.
When did you lose control?
Did you ever have?
As soon as I introduced you incorrectly, apparently.
So, well, what I'm curious about is the great debate, because there's probably people who are watching this who are saying, well, I could never do that. And there's this debate about, you know, talent versus not having to have talent. What are your thoughts on... So somebody who's watching this has never drawn, they've never picked up a paintbrush, they look at it and they go, gee, I'd like to do that, but I don't believe in my heart that I could really do it. What are your thoughts on that?
My thoughts are, you know, I get often told by people that think, I can't do that, I just don't have the natural talent, I wasn't born with it. And to them I'd say, nobody's really born with it. It's a matter of how often you practice and how much attention you give to it. You know, nobody's born as a good basketball player either.
Well, and I think that's really a great point. Nobody says, you know, you see a concert musician in Carnegie Hall, they don't say, well, he was born with natural talent, or a great surgeon, right?
Right. Well, I think it's passion, and what you would desire is a form of prayer.
Right.
And if you really want something badly enough, you can excel at it. And I do teach total beginners that have never picked up a paintbrush. A lot of people, our contemporaries, are wanting to start painting for the first time, and it's very intimidating.
Yeah.
But I have a kind of very simple step-by-step approach, as do many teachers. And that's what I think. You know, it's fun to get a small set of paints and just play with them at home. And then there's wonderful DVDs and online tutorials, and looking at magazines
and
workshops.
You know, the tribe is so welcoming.
There's ways
artists are wonderful people to
learn.
Fun to be around.
Right. And we've had a great time. So just to kind of recap what we did today, it's kind of an interesting story, Kyle.
Yeah.
So share a little bit of how you brought us all together.
This is how this kind of came up. I mean, I've known you guys for years and years and years, but I was approached to do a TV show maybe a year ago. So this was a TV show based in LA, where the studio was, and part of that, it's really a lifestyle type show.
Are we allowed to share with
him? I think it's fine. Modern Living with Kathy Ireland.
Yes.
So I was on that show this week down in Santa Barbara, and before the show was taped, it'll air in March, and then again, I think, in September, and again next year in April. So part of this was, they said, we'd like you to build a story around lifestyle interests and related to what you do with the art. So this whole concept was, let me talk about our company a little bit, our culture within our company. Let me talk a little bit about the art world and different facets of it, because the plein air movement and you guys is one very important part of the art world that we see. But I'm also involved with Comic-Con, and I'm involved with every aspect, because we're
like blind, even graffiti type.
Yeah, street art.
Yeah, street art.
Yeah, yes. all those kind of things. So this was an opportunity for me to also do some interviews and do some field work as a part of that show. And I did one at New York Comic Con, and we talked to a lot of comic book artists and illustrators, and totally different than the three of us going out to paint.
Right.
And then the other thing I wanted to focus on to kind of balance that was, you know, here's this other angle of the arts, how you can incorporate it, not, you know, at any point in your life for various different reasons, and how that's important. And the third piece was really talking about art advocacy and art education. Mm-hmm. So we did some nonprofit philanthropical work.
You do a lot of that.
Yeah.
No, it's
great,
important.
Great, you know, we have art to give education. Back. Yeah.
Yeah, we do have a huge art education. Well, I say huge. We've got an education director, you know, big for the size of our company.
He's doing a great job.
It goes out to maybe 50 to 60 different universities.
Right.
But we try to educate. It's part of our mission statement is to inspire, engage, and inform.
Yeah.
So the inform part is the educational component. But also we try to really focus on other organizations that are moving the ball forward and advancing things that we need in our society,
right.
Like more funding for the arts, more, you know, so I work with a lot of universities like RISD for the STEM to STEAM program, trying to get the arts incorporated into the...
Well, and you worked with us on our veterans program. Yeah. So we did, I don't know if you know about
that. No, I didn't know.
At last year's plein air convention, mm-hmm. We announced that we were going to do a veterans program because there's a lot of evidence that PTSD is reduced, or at least they're given a chance to get a break away from it. So we got about 200 people enlisted around the country to start teaching the veterans. And I know you were donating some supplies and so on to that.
Oh, that's great. Right. I do that locally with a group called Higher Ground, which is similar. I teach art to them, and it's really rewarding.
Yeah. It's great. We have such
very
a need for that.
Healing for them. Yeah.
There's another great one. I think it's down in Texas near you. Wounded Warrior.
Mm-hmm. Yes, very similar.
Yeah. I think they're great. I mean, there's just so many things that the arts can do.
Art is very healing.
It's very healing, but it's also, I think, very developmental.
Yes.
You know, I have two kids. Shout out to Cassidy and Cameron if they're watching, and Alyssa, my wife. But they, you know, they really have studied quite well the development in the brain that happens with children and the arts. And what,
right.
Which is one of the tragedies of not having art programs in our schools.
Yeah.
So my kids happen to go to a school that values it, art and music, and they have all this evidence about how it develops the brain. Mm-hmm. And so those kinds of things are really critical. And I think your mission, mine certainly, is to try to look for ways to get that back into either into the curriculum or at least find ways that people can discover it through online lessons or online academies or, you know, free videos or whatever.
That's great.
It's really important, even as if you look at it at a grander scale, to the competitive nature of our country.
Yeah.
You know, how are we going to compete in the 21st, 22nd century? It's through innovation. And without the arts and education as young children, there's so many things that won't come out of those kids when they grow
up. Art is on the forefront of every great society. You
Absolutely.
Know, every important civilization, art, you know, sprouted.
You know, Winston Churchill said when they wanted to reduce funding because of World War II, they said, you know, they're going to cut some arts funding. And he said, well, if we cut the arts, what are we fighting for?
Right.
You know, it was really...
Yeah.
Well, that's what I love about our town, Sun Valley, here, is it's very supportive of the arts.
Mm-hmm. Winston Churchill was a plein air painter, too.
Yes, he was.
Yeah. I did know that. Yeah.
Because his wife didn't want him inside smoking cigars.
There you go. So are there any parting words? We could just have so much fun. We love to have chat, and we could sit here a lot longer than we should. But anything else you'd like to share before we sign off?
I'll take that one. I think it's really important for the people who might be watching this to not tell yourself that you can't do this.
Yes.
You know, you if you find some art that inspires you, you're looking on a website, or you maybe take a visit to a museum or look at books or whatever, look at something that inspires you and don't tell yourself you can't do it. You can do it. You can learn it. All you have to do is get somebody to teach you. If you try to learn it on your own, that's okay, but you're going to get frustrated. Mm-hmm. And you're going to get frustrated no matter what, but don't give up when you get frustrated. That's the thing to understand.
I agree.
I do a free video online called paintbynote.com. And it's what I've done is I've reduced it down to basically black and white painting, because that's I think, one of the proper ways to learn.
It is, yeah.
Because it's all about, a painting will look good even in black and white, and then you, and then I teach you how to add color on top
That's
of it.
Great.
But color is a very important part of things, but you want to learn the basics of painting before
exactly.
you add the color. And then this guy's got all this color.
Okay, and then, that's
yeah,
right.
so, and that's, I think what's great about the three of us is like we bring different elements of it to the table. But, you know, for me, what you said is so important, Eric. You know, get out there and paint, just do it. You know, if you don't,
just
if the voice
it.
Is telling you in your head, like Van Gogh
we
said, if that,
that
voice is telling you in your head, you can't do it. Just paint, because you'll silence
it. It'll silence it.
But I mean, for me, it's also, you know, we have products that are specifically designed for the plein air movement. You
right.
know, like Cobra, we've got, this is our solvent-free oil paint that
And that's,
that
that's
we
my
use.
Favorite.
Yeah,
I specialize
require,
in that, right.
Yeah, it doesn't require
so
any solvents.
Explain why that might be important.
Well, because especially a lot of people that are coming into painting for the first time may not have a beautiful studio like this with ventilation. They may not, you know, be able to travel where they want to go, taking solvents. And most importantly, they may have health, either want to live a healthier life or have health concerns that are allergies
right.
To solvents. So if there's a way to paint using oils, which is such a beautiful technique to work in,
so people
without having the solvents.
But if somebody doesn't know what a solvent is, can you explain what that is?
A solvent would be like a turpentine
right.
or an odorless mineral spirit that is used to break down the oil paint traditionally so that it's thinned out or that you clean up with it. And it's a very, it's been used for a couple hundred years. It's not as old as some people think, but it's something that can be very toxic, especially to respiratory systems,
mm-hmm.
but it can get into your,
and it's bad. Gets
into your skin through your
yes.
Cuticles, and it can
right.
have nerve damage issues
yeah.
For
it's
people.
Serious
I know
stuff.
Too many artists who, you know, used a lot of spirits and turpentine, and it just, it has fried their brains. So we want people to be able to paint without fear of any kind of health.
And
you
so,
just figured it out. That's why there's so many crazy artists.
That's it.
That's only one of the reasons, Eric.
That's right. Well, guys, we need to let you get on the road. You're going to fly back home to Austin, and we're going to get some lunch.
Yeah, we are.
We Sounds worked good. Up an appetite out there. And so thank you so much. This has been such a treat being with you both. And I look forward to seeing you in a couple months at the Plein Air Convention in San mm-hmm. Francisco this year. Hope some of you will join us in San Francisco.
And by the way, you don't have to be a painter to come.
No.
You'll learn to be a painter
that's
there.
That's right.
Yeah.
You will learn from some of the top artists in the country and even the world. So thank you for being here today. And again, I'm Lori McNee with ArtBeat.